MTN News, this is Montana This Morning.
And good morning on this Thursday. Welcome to Montana This Morning. I'm Andrea Lutz. We are learning more this morning surrounding Montana's fentanyl crisis. Parents who lost children to drug overdoses are pleading for everyone to now carry Narcan. This gathering in Rose Park is all about spreading the word that fentanyl-related deaths are on the rise, and families say even people who don't use drugs should carry Narcan with them. It could save a life of someone overdosing on opioids.
It's actually biochemically reversing the opioid in the body, and it reverses the respiratory depression. So people that are not breathing start breathing again, and they become awake and alert, and they sit up, and then they can be tended to by paramedics.
In most cases, fentanyl isn't a drug that people take intentionally. Dealers mix it with other popular illegal substances, including cocaine. And new this morning, a new fentanyl threat is emerging in the U.S. Cartels are now making the drug colorful. It looks like candy, and it may be designed to trick young people or even kids. CBS's Trinity Chavez reports.
The Drug Enforcement Administration is alerting the public of an alarming trend, releasing these images of colorful fentanyl, also being called rainbow fentanyl. The pills and powder come in bright colors, shapes, and sizes. Fred Munch is with the Partnership to End Addiction.
The game has changed in terms of pills and powder now because they are laced with fentanyl. And getting the word out is so important because the users are unsuspecting. They don't know that they're taking a pill with fentanyl in it.
Federal drug officials say the so-called rainbow fentanyl appears to be a new method from the drug cartels to appeal to young people. This month alone, law enforcement has seized rainbow fentanyl in 18 states.
Statistics show fentanyl is the deadliest drug threat facing the United States.
More than 107,000 Americans died of drug overdoses in 2021. 66% of those deaths were related to synthetic opioids like fentanyl.
Unfortunately, it's getting worse. We're seeing more and more fentanyl coming in. Traditional opioids are falling off the radar of them because it's so much cheaper to use fentanyl.
Knowing the dangers of using counterfeit prescription pills.
Last year, the DEA launched an awareness campaign educating Americans about how just one pill can kill. Trinity Chavez, CBS News, New York.
Drug poisonings are the leading killer of Americans between the ages of 18 and 45. Okay, Miller is here with us now. Morning. We've made it to Thursday. You know, we call Wednesday hump day, and I was like, we should come up with something for Thursday. What to call Thursday?
I don't know. Friday Eve, almost Friday. My goodness, we've hit Friday the Thursday Eve. Wall. I don't know. What all could you call it?
Is that a thing, do you think, the Thursday wall?
Yeah, I think so, especially for us. I mean, we've been up since, what, May? we get up so early in the morning, you know, so we, but toward the end of the week, me and Rob call Wednesday, I think, the Wednesday wall.
Yeah, it's so true.
Yeah, but me, I start to get a little excited on Thursday because I know it's almost the weekend.
Just one more day. It's true. Yeah, just one more day. You can see the end in sight.
Yeah, you know what? And I wish I could give you better news in terms of more September-like weather, but it ain't happening. It's going to be another hot day today. Some areas actually may flirt with some record temperatures today. We'll have to wait until Saturday for that to happen here in Billings. We'll tell you more about that with the breakdown in the main forecast coming up. 68 right now at the airport, so it's warmer than normal. Humidity at 31%, dew points at 36. We're going to have to keep an eye on that today because it's going to be very dry today. Some areas red flag warning. We'll show you that here coming up. Winds out of the southwest at about 14 miles an hour. 50s and 60s as we get up in Adam, 90s and some triple digits this afternoon. Now, Andrea, we'll get a bit of a break tomorrow. We do have this cold front that's going to sweep through. It'll cool us down. I mean, when we say 90, 91, and we're excited about that being cool, that shows you just how hot it's been.
Yeah.
And then we're going to heat right back up again. So in the Labor Day weekend, if you've got a pool handy, you'll definitely want to stay in it. Maybe take a dip or two. Yeah.
You had some interesting numbers yesterday just about, like, usually September, you don't head into September being so hot.
Yeah.
So it's kind of an anomaly a little bit.
So 103 is the record to start September here back in 1983. We won't get there today, but it may feel like it.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. All right, Miller. Thanks so much. We'll see you soon.
Okay.
All right. Abortion access continues to shrink across the country in the wake of Roe v. Wade, and now women don't have access to surgical abortions in Billings. Construction is underway on that Heights Planned Parenthood. As Casey Conlon reports, the closure is just temporary.
As Montana's neighbors continue to restrict abortion access, the Treasure State might soon find itself as the only option in the region. But providers here are struggling as well. This Billings Heights Planned Parenthood location, which was the city's only option for surgical abortions, has been closed since December.
We had had a pipe burst in the health center and flood the entire building.
It's been a supply chain and contractor nightmare ever since. Planned Parenthood of Montana CEO Martha Fuller said they hope to have the clinic open again this fall, but for now, patients seeking surgical abortions have to go to Helena, 250 miles away from Billings and much farther for most of the region.
Even before this happened, we would get calls from patients who were, you know, already surprised at how far they would have to travel.
Medication abortions are still available at Planned Parenthood's West End Clinic up to 11 weeks into a pregnancy. But surgical abortions can be performed up to about 21 weeks in Montana. And there are currently only three options in the state: the Helena Planned Parenthood, Blue Mountain Clinic in Missoula, and All Families Healthcare in Whitefish.
We get a lot of calls of people who are just curious if we're still providing abortion. Whether or not they're seeking it for themselves, I think people are just a bit unclear on whether it's still legal in Montana.
A 1999 Montana Supreme Court decision made it legal, though Governor Greg Gianforte has asked the court to overturn the decision. It remains legal for now in Idaho, Wyoming, and North Dakota, but access is still very limited. North Dakota's only clinic moved across the Minnesota state line this summer after seeing the writing on the wall.
The percentage of patients that have come to Montana from adjoining states historically has been anywhere from 10% in a sort of a lower year, anywhere up to about, you know, 25% of our patients coming from out of state.
13 states have already passed abortion trigger laws, and Fuller says it's only a matter of time before Montana sees a jump.
In Colorado, for example, they're already seeing patients from Texas, Arizona, et cetera. And so as those appointment slots fill up, I do expect we'll see patients from all around the country, not necessarily next to us.
A cascading effect.
Exactly, sort of a domino effect.
In Billings, Casey Conlon, MTN News.
There are some new concerns this morning over the safety of Lake Elmo Drive after a child was hit by a car there this week. 7-year-old Monroe Webster is sore and out of the hospital, doing well. Well, the driver said the young boy ran into the street, but parents say the area is unsafe for pedestrians. Megan Vaden's 8-year-old was also hit by a car and is recovering from a severe concussion. So moms want the city to make Lake Elmo Drive safer.
Something has to be done because it's not fair for our kids to not be able to go play without thinking they're going to get hit by a car. So something should change.
And residents living along Lake Elmo, they say that enforcement of those speeds need to be a little bit better. They also say for years people have been speeding in the area. Happening today, an important hearing regarding the search of Donald Trump's home. His legal team says the search of Mar-a-Lago is deeply flawed. Prosecutors say the documents weren't Trump's to keep. CBS's Bradley Blackburn has more.
In a new court filing, the Trump legal team once again asked that a third-party special master be appointed to review documents seized from Mar-a-Lago. This comes a day after the Justice Department tried to swat down that request, arguing, among other things, that they had already completed a review of potentially privileged material. A federal judge in West Palm Beach is set to hold a hearing on the request today. In the filing, Trump's lawyers call the August 8th execution of a search warrant at his estate unprecedented, unnecessary, and legally unsupported. But the DOJ says on June 3rd, 2 months before the search of Mar-a-Lago, Trump's team told them all sensitive documents had been returned.
When they executed the search warrant, it turned out they had not been turned over.
Trump claims he declassified documents at his home, but in its filing, the government stated that Trump's lawyers never asserted that he had declassified the documents or asserted any claim of executive privilege. The DOJ also says it had evidence that government records were likely concealed and removed from the storage room, and that efforts were likely taken to obstruct the government's investigation.
This pleading gives a lot of details about the obstruction investigation, not only against the target of their investigation, but also as to other individuals who may have been assisting the target of their investigation.
The filing also includes this redacted FBI photograph taken at Mar-a-Lago showing documents and classified cover sheets, some marked as top secret. Bradley Blackburn, CBS News.
And the Justice Department says documents were found in Trump's so-called 45 office at Mar-a-Lago, a location considered vulnerable. Happening later today, President Biden will deliver a primetime speech at Philadelphia's Independence Hall. The White House says the remarks will focus on what they call an extreme threat to democracy. House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy will give his own speech ahead of the president's from Biden's hometown in Scranton, Pennsylvania. Now, this morning, we are getting you ready for the Labor Day weekend. Millions are planning to travel. Inflation costs are slowly starting to come down, too. But as CBS's Elise Preston reports, there are other disruptions.
Ashlyn Schaefer did plenty of research to find the best deal for her trip to New York.
I booked early, so that helped. I also took a red eye, so that helped cut down some of the cost.
Airline ticket prices are getting cheaper.
Airfare prices are the lowest that they've been since February of this year.
Haley Berg is with the travel site Hopper.
We saw airfare really take off this spring and summer with prices peaking over $400 per ticket. But airfare in August is down to about $286 per round trip ticket. And that's below 2019 prices.
The travel app Hopper predicts close to 13 million Americans will fly during the Labor Day weekend. For frequent flyer Eris Marganon, it's already been a summer of travel issues.
We did get like 3 flights delayed.
And we expect that to continue through Labor Day weekend. Today, about 1 in 4 flights are being delayed on departure, and about 3 to 4% of flights are being canceled.
Experts say booking the earliest flight out in the morning can help you avoid delays, and they advise getting a direct flight so you don't run the risk of missing a connection.
Most Labor Day travelers will drive and are seeing some relief at the gas pump. The national average for a gallon is down more than a dollar from June's record highs.
I haven't seen prices like that since, last year.
Hopper says car rental prices are down about 20% in the past 2 months, but still higher than last year. People who can vacation after Labor Day may find some good deals. Travel experts expect prices to drop in September and October, then go back up before the holidays. Elise Preston, CBS News, LaGuardia Airport, New York.
And the busiest days to fly, of course, are today and tomorrow. A group of Montanans working to make housing in Montana more affordable. Governor Greg Gianforte put together a group earlier this summer made of advocates, lawmakers, and business owners. Members are focusing on those small towns next to tourist hotspots. And one suggestion is to treat owners of short-term rentals more like they're in the hotel industry.
We know that short-term rentals are a challenge, especially for many of Montana's gateway communities that serve the national parks. And one potential solution to help those communities more effectively deal with that challenge would be simply to the Department of Revenue does collect the lodging facility use tax for their short-term rentals. One potential solution that would help these gateway communities deal with that would be to simply require the Department of Revenue to disclose the information about how many of these things exist and how many rental days they're serving.
The task force will meet again and they want to hear from you. You can submit comments and ideas for lower housing ideas. You can find the story on our website, ktvq.com. The Department of Defense is now listing climate change as a national security threat. It's why the U.S. Army is now working to implement a sweeping green energy strategy. CBS's Natalie Brand shows us how it's going.
At Fort Meade in Maryland, home to U.S. Cyber Command and the National Security Agency, guarding against climate change is a mission priority.
A 21st century warfare needs 21st century energy.
Colonel Michael Sapp says that means beefing up clean energy, with solar panels now topping nearly 60% of housing here.
55% of the electricity comes from renewable energy.
The base also has plans to transform this landfill into a 60-acre solar farm, energy that can power Fort Meade if the grid takes a hit.
We can't afford to lose power. Losing power means we lose training and we lose operations.
Assistant Secretary of the Army for Installations, Energy and the Environment, Rachel Jacobson, oversees the climate strategy, which includes building a microgrid on every base by 2035. The Army is also targeting 2030 for a 50% reduction in net greenhouse gas pollution and net zero emissions by 2050.
Is that realistic?
We hope it is. I mean, if you don't set goals and ambitions, then you don't have anything to strive for. We think that we certainly have the capacity on military installations to try innovative solutions and technologies to achieve these goals.
At Fort Bragg in North Carolina, innovation includes a floating solar array, the largest of its kind in the Southeast. Fort Carson in Colorado is working on new battery technology, and Fort Leonard Wood in Missouri has added electric vehicle charging stations.
They're allowing us to be a part of the change as the Army chooses to be more progressive.
Sergeant Brittany Washington, who's also a mother of three, knows tackling climate change can't wait.
If we can get ahead of it now, then the future, of course, will be a better Army for it.
The urgent threat the Army is now training to fight. Natalie Brand, CBS News, Fort Meade, Maryland.
And thank you for joining us here on Billings Only Local Morning Newscast. Coming up, we have more news, including high school athletic programs working overtime to try and get a hold of football helmets. That's because they're in short supply. We'll explain why it's happening. 62 degrees outside in Billings right now. The time is 5:15. We're back with more news after this. And welcome back on this Thursday. It's 5:17. The supply chain crisis is now extending to the high school fields. Teams don't have enough helmets, and coaches and players are struggling to make do with what they do have. CBS's Wendy Gillette has the story.
Wide receiver Drew Cortese is wearing a helmet that doesn't quite fit.
I was given a large helmet, but the issue was that it was too big and it would wobble around. Like when I tackle, it like move a lot.
The Irvington High School football player who had a concussion last season would rather have a medium, but there are none left. And when practice started this season, not everyone had a helmet.
Everybody else was doing things with pads or helmets when you couldn't because there wasn't enough for all of us.
This team and other high school football programs across the country are feeling the impact of the global supply chain crisis.
So how big of a problem has this been?
This has been a pretty significant problem for our program. We have roughly 40 players on our team, and we don't have enough helmets for every player. So we've had to dip down into our 7th and 8th grade team supply.
Blue 80, hot!
It's the same situation at Walpole High School outside Boston.
Our reps that we're buying the helmets from, and they're probably getting a text or an email a day from all these coaches. You know, I just sent one an hour ago. It's any updates, and there's nothing yet.
Only two companies make these helmets, and they're not cheap, running anywhere from $300 to $1,000 a piece.
The companies have been honest and upfront with telling us that they're not getting the clips and the interior padding of the helmets because of the supply chain. And even when they are getting helmets ready, the supply chain is taking forever to get those helmets out to the schools.
One, two, three, go!
A new order of helmets should be delivered to the Irvington Bulldogs sometime this season, they hope. Wendy Gillette, CBS News, Irvington, New York.
And stay with us. Weather is coming up next.
Storm Tracker weather starts now with meteorologist Miller Robson.
Time now is 5:21. Thank you so much for starting your Thursday with us. Getting closer and closer to the weekend. Hang on, we are going to get there together. Called for a high yesterday of 97. That's exactly where we hit. Trying to get a little hotter today. How about that? 62 for the overnight low, so it was milder than normal. A bit breezy at times yesterday. We're going to feel those winds maybe gusting today. Could have gusts up to about 25 miles an hour, if not stronger, and that's going to pose a problem. I'll tell you why here in just a second. No rain yesterday, lots of sunshine. Still holding steady at 0.47 inches for the month, just over 12 inches for the year, so we're still sliding back in terms of the moisture for this month, but we're still on the plus side for the year as a whole. First day of fall, well, the countdown is on. It is September 1st, 21 days and counting. It kicks off Thursday, September 22nd at 7:03 here local time. The question is, will it feel like fall? Here's the latest outlook projected for September, and it doesn't look too good. A really decent chance that we are going to be warmer than average. I say warmer than average, not hotter than average, because there's a chance, you know, we should be, you know, upper 70s, low 80s. We may be at 84, 85, 86 degrees as we get into the middle of the month and beyond. So we're not going to be extremely hot, but we are going to be warmer than average. Now that outlook could change. Fingers are crossed. I don't know about you, but I am so over this hot temperature, these hot temperatures. That's why I left the South. But unfortunately, it looks like I brought the hot temperatures with me. 68 at the airport, humidity at 31%, dew points at 36, winds out of the southwest at about 14 miles an hour. Take a look at temperatures across the area. Mainly in the 50s and 60s, our cool spot again this morning, White Sulphur Springs, sitting at 48 degrees. Across the state, pretty much the same thing. See, we do have some rain off to our west and southwest. That's not going to make its way into our area. This is out ahead of a cold front. What we will get, though, a bit of a cool down tomorrow with that front passing through. It's not going to be a huge cool down. Some of us may still stay in the 90s. If you're lucky, you may get down into the 80s before we heat right back up again. All right, let's talk about the dew points. We're going to see those dew points staying today mainly in the 30s and 40s. A lot of 30s out there. Relative humidity could get down into the low teens in some spots today. You combine that with the winds, which are calm right now, but as we go along today, we're going to have the opportunity to see some gusts, maybe over 25 miles an hour. You combine those winds with that low humidity, and that means we have an increased fire risk as we go along today, especially those areas shaded there, including Garfield, Petroleum, and Marr County in the Q2 viewing area. That's through tonight. So even if you're not officially in that area, all of us today, it's still going to be very dry for the most part in the Q2 viewing area. So don't do anything that's going to cause any sparking this afternoon. So the big story again today, hot and dry, high pressure continuing to dominate. Here's that cold front that's going to drop through by late tomorrow morning. It's going to bring those temperatures down just a bit. Still going to be hotter than normal. And then they're just going to rebound as we get into Saturday. And on Saturday, several spots, Livingston, Cody, Mile City, Sheridan here in Billings, all a chance to see record daytime highs on Saturday as we get into the long, dry and hot holiday weekend. Time now is 5:25. Here's your Ag Report.
From MTN News, this is Montana This Morning.
Good morning. Welcome to Montana This Morning. It is Thursday. We're so glad that you are with us. 5:30 is the time right now. Good morning to you, Miller.
Good morning,
how are
Andrea.
You doing?
I'm doing good. Getting closer to the weekend.
Yeah, excellent. It's going to be a really great weekend.
And good morning, everyone. A great shot of Lady Liberty.
Yeah, and we think that it looks like she is taking a selfie from this angle.
There you go.
We like that a lot.
It looks like they're doing some work there or something. I'm not exactly sure.
It's like some construction there.
Construction going on, maybe sprucing her up just a little bit. So you've never been to the Statue of Liberty?
No, I haven't. It's on my bucket list, of course.
When I was a kid and a military family, we moved to Germany and we did a layover in New York City at the airport, and I just remember briefly catching a glimpse of her out the window of the airplane.
Yeah.
And I was so young, I didn't know what it was, but would have loved to have had a chance to go up there. And maybe one day. I think it's like a waiting list to
really
get up in there. Yeah, so I don't think you can just show up. But give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses for us. Give us some fall weather. Gee whiz, man, it is hot out there. 68 right now. It is mild. We should be low, mid-50s at the airport. We're nowhere near that. I don't know exactly when we'll ever see that coming up in the next couple of weeks. It's just going to stay very, very hot. Humidity at 31%, dew points at 36, winds out of the southwest at about 14 miles an hour. As we wake up this morning, just a mild start. We do have a little bit of rain, blotches of rain there off to our west. Dry today, very hot. You can see some triple digits. Could see some records, especially by Saturday. We will take a look at that forecast coming up. Andrea.
All right, thanks so much, Miller. For the next few months, abortion access in Montana will be even harder to come by. The Planned Parenthood in the Billings Heights has been shut down since December, leaving Helena as the closest clinic offering surgical abortions. The temporary closure is not Roe v. Wade related. Instead, a burst pipe is to blame. And our neighboring states, as they look to pass abortion bans, there'll be a lack of access in Billings. It's going to be felt even farther away, too.
The percentage of patients that have come to Montana from adjoining states historically has been anywhere from 10% in a sort of a lower year, anywhere up to about, 25% of our patients coming from out of state. In Colorado, for example, they're already seeing patients from Texas, Arizona, et cetera. And so as those appointment slots fill up, I do expect we'll see patients from all around the country. Not necessarily next to us.
A cascading effect.
Exactly. Sort of a domino effect.
Last week, federal judges blocked trigger laws in North Dakota and Idaho. Abortion is still legal in Wyoming while a lawsuit plays out in court. The Heights Planned Parenthood is expected to be back up and running again sometime this fall. There are new concerns this morning over the safety of Lake Elmo Drive after a child was hit by a car. 7-year-old Monroe Webster is sore, but out of the hospital and doing well. And the driver said that the young boy ran into the street, but parents say the area is just unsafe for pedestrians. Megan Vaden's 8-year-old was also struck by a car and is recovering from a severe concussion. The moms want the city to make Lake Elmo Drive safer.
Something has to be done because it's not fair for our kids to not be able to go play without thinking they're going to get hit by a car. So
something should change.
Residents living along Lake Elmo Drive say enforcement of the speed needs to be better, and they say for years people have been speeding in the area. Happening today, an important hearing regarding the search of Donald Trump's home. His legal team says the search of Mar-a-Lago is deeply flawed, but prosecutors say the documents weren't Trump's to keep. CBS's Bradley Blackburn has more.
In a new court filing, the Trump legal team once again asked that a third-party special master be appointed to review documents seized from Mar-a-Lago. This comes a day after the Justice Department tried to swat down that request, arguing, among other things, that they had already completed a review of potentially privileged material. A federal judge in West Palm Beach is set to hold a hearing on the request today. In the filing, Trump's lawyers call the August 8th execution of a search warrant at his estate unprecedented, unnecessary, and legally unsupported. But the DOJ says on June 3rd, 2 months before the search of Mar-a-Lago, Trump's team told them all sensitive documents had been returned.
When they executed the search warrant, it turned out they had not been turned over.
Trump claims he declassified documents at his home, but in its filing, the government stated that Trump's lawyers never asserted that he had declassified the documents or asserted any claim of executive privilege. The DOJ also says it had evidence that government records were likely concealed and removed from the storage room, and that efforts were likely taken to obstruct the government's investigation.
This pleading gives a lot of details about the obstruction investigation, not only against the target of their investigation, but also as to other individuals who may have been assisting the target of their investigation.
The filing also includes this redacted FBI photograph taken at Mar-a-Lago showing documents and classified cover sheets, some marked as top secret. Bradley Blackburn, CBS News.
Well, the Justice Department says documents were found in Trump's so-called 45 office at Mar-a-Lago, a location that is considered to be vulnerable. We are learning more this morning surrounding Montana's fentanyl crisis. Parents who lost children to drug overdoses are pleading for everyone to now carry Narcan. This gathering at Rose Park is all about spreading the word that fentanyl-related deaths are on the rise, and families say even people who don't use drugs should carry Narcan. It could save a life from someone overdosing on opioids.
It's actually biochemically reversing the opioid in the body, and it reverses the respiratory depression. So people that are not breathing start breathing again, and they become awake and alert, and they sit up, and then they can be tended to by paramedics.
In most cases, fentanyl isn't a drug that people take intentionally. In fact, dealers mix it with other popular illegal substances like cocaine. Meanwhile, the DEA is warning about rainbow fentanyl, a new trend that's emerging across the country. The pills and powder come in bright colors and candy-like shapes and sizes. It appears to be a new method from the drug cartels to appeal to young people. And this month alone, police seized rainbow fentanyl in 18 states. They say just one pill can kill. And this morning, we're getting you ready for Labor Day weekend. Millions are planning to travel as inflation costs start to slow down and come down. But as CBS's Elise Preston reports, there are other disruptions.
Ashlyn Schaefer did plenty of research to find the best deal for her trip to New York.
I booked early, so that helped. I also took a red eye, so that helped cut down some of the cost.
Airline ticket prices are getting cheaper.
Airfare prices are the lowest that they've been since February of this year.
Haley Berg is with the travel site Hopper.
We saw airfare really take off this spring and summer with prices peaking over $400 per ticket. But airfare in August is down to about $286 per round trip ticket. And that's below 2019 prices.
The travel app Hopper predicts close to 13 million Americans will fly during the Labor Day weekend. For frequent flyer Eris Marganon, it's already been a summer of travel issues.
We did get like 3 flights delayed.
And we expect that to continue through Labor Day weekend. Today, about 1 in 4 flights are being delayed on departure, and about 3 to 4% of flights are being canceled.
Experts say booking the earliest flight out in the morning can help you avoid delays, and they advise getting a direct flight so you don't run the risk of missing a connection.
Most Labor Day travelers will drive and are seeing some relief at the gas pump. The national average for a gallon is down more than a dollar from June's record highs.
I haven't seen prices like that since, gosh, last year.
Hopper says car rental prices are down about 20% in the past 2 months, but still higher than last year. People who can vacation after Labor Day may find some good deals. Travel experts expect prices to drop in September and October, then go back up before the holidays. Elise Preston, CBS News, LaGuardia Airport, New York.
And the busiest days to travel are today and tomorrow. Happening later today, President Biden will deliver a primetime speech at Philadelphia's Independence Hall. The White House says the remarks will focus on what they call an extreme threat to democracy. House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy will give his own speech ahead of the president's from Biden's hometown in Scranton, Pennsylvania. Today, a team of investigators and inspectors will assess the security and safety situation at Ukraine's nuclear plant. Their expected arrival comes as another reactor to the plant was shut down due to shelling. There's growing concern that shelling in the area will cause a radiation leak. The White House has a new recruitment plan to address the teacher shortage. Biden teamed up with job search companies to help districts fill those jobs. Indeed will host virtual hiring fairs, while the site Handshake will reach out to undergrad students in education, and ZipRecruiter has a new online job portal for K through 12 teachers. The White House is also urging state leaders to use money from the American Rescue Plan to boost teacher pay. Later today, a CDC advisory panel will decide who should get a new COVID-19 booster. The FDA already authorized new booster shots for both Moderna and Pfizer. The booster could be available in a matter of days. A study out today shows how the pandemic impacted school kids. The National Center for Education Statistics finds that the average math score for a 9-year-old student fell 7 points in the last 2 years. The average reading score fell about 5 points. A group of Montanans is working to make housing in Montana more affordable. Governor Greg Gianforte put together the group earlier this summer, made of advocates, lawmakers, and business owners. Members are focusing right now on small towns next to tourist hotspots, and one suggestion is to treat owners of short-term rentals like they're in the hotel industry.
We know that short-term rentals are a challenge, especially for many of Montana's gateway communities that serve the national parks. And one potential solution to help those communities more effectively deal with that challenge would be simply to, the Department of Revenue does collect the lodging facility use tax for their short-term rentals. One potential solution that would help these gateway communities deal with that would be to simply require the Department of Revenue to disclose the information about how many of these things exist and how many rental days they're serving.
As the task force meets again, they do want to hear from you. You can submit comments and ideas for lower housing on our website, ktvq.com. Well, thanks for watching Billings' only local morning newscast. It's Thursday. We're just one day away from the weekend. Coming up at 5:51, a NASA robot may hold the key to one day having humans living on Mars. Wow, we'll explain. The time is 5:41, 62 degrees out there. Miller has a look at that weather coming up after the break.